And the one is that the pumps that increases the energy of the fluid. So you have the inlet of the pump and the outlet with high energy. The low energy fluid comes and leaves with high energy fluid. And this one is the pump. Actually, the shaft of the pump, this one is connected to a motor, and that motor rotates this one. And for the pump, you will need that electricity in. This one needs electricity. But for the turbine, you can see high energy fluid with high kinetic energy one comes into contact with the blades of the turbine, and as it rotates, it gets the energy of the fluid and it leaves with kinetic energy two. And this kinetic energy two is less than kinetic energy one. It uses the energy of the fluid. And these are the called that turbines. And the wind turbine is a special form of the turbines, and this one gives you electricity. And another classification for the turbo machines is that we have different classifications. One is that according due to the volume that they are working, it can be positive displacement ones and it can be turbo machines. Firstly, the turbo machines, they can absorb energy by using incompressible fluid or compressible fluid. If it uses incompressible fluid, it will be pumps or propellers. Okay. This propeller is, for example, that ship propeller. And it can be that pump. Okay, it uses the pump is used working with incompressible fluid. And if it is compressible fluid, you can have the fan that is everywhere. You can see the fans, blowers, and the compressors. These are for the power absorbing ones. Power absorbing means that they use electricity. It uses electricity. For the power producing ones, you can have again incompressible fluid and the compressible fluid. For incompressible fluid, we have the Pelton turbine and we have the hydraulic turbine. Okay, these are for incompressible ones, Pelton and the hydraulic. For the compressible ones, we have the steam turbine that works with the steam. We have the gas turbine that works with air or gas. And we have the wind turbine. We have talked about this one. And here you have the wind turbine. This is the classification for the dynamic machines or the turbo machines. We have also another classification which is based on the degree of reaction. So I will talk about in next slides what is that degree of reaction. And it can also be the impulse type. So for the first with the impulse type, here you have that pressure as constant. So here, P doesn't change. And it uses the momentum of the flow. So it uses MV. A momentum of the flow, and this momentum, according this classification, you can have the Pelton turbine and the wind turbine. It uses the MV. But for the reaction turbines, here you have the degree of reaction and the pressure drops. And this drop of pressure, the drop of pressure, as I said, is measured by degree of reaction. And the more degree of reaction means that more drop of pressure. These are called the reaction turbines. As the name says, the reaction. It measures the amount of the reaction that the fluid has with the blades according to the drop of pressure. It can be axial type. Axial type means that flow goes in that direction and leaves, this one is a turbine, and leaves in the same direction. It can be a radial type. Flow comes into turbine in that direction and leaves in that way. Or the pump. It can be pump or the turbine, it doesn't matter. For the mixed type, flow comes in that direction to the device or the fluid machine, and it can live in that. Now, either it is not that is, it is not either radial or axial. Okay, it is a mixed one. This one is the inlet, and this one is inlet, and this one is inlet. Okay. For the power absorbing ones, we can also have the classification as the uncased ones and the cased ones. As I said, it moves in that way. It can also be radial type, and it moves in that way, and it can be mixed type in that way. Okay. So you can have that case around it, and you can ha not have the un you could have the uncased option, which is that axial flow propeller. Okay. This one is, for example, I can give the for ship, or it can be that aircraft. So you can see that there is no casing around the flow. Okay, so that positive displacement ones, we have not talked about this one. Okay, that the boundary work. Here the main thing is that you have the boundary work. So you have this one is your device, and here you have the piston. This one is the general configuration. Okay, you have the piston here, and this piston moves up and down, and you have a closed volume here, closed constant, closed volume. And the volume boundary changes, but that total amount of the volume that you can change is fixed. Okay, and by the movement of this boundary, you are adding energy to the fluid. And these are called the positive displacement ones. And the famous example can be that, for example, the car engine. It is a positive displacement one. Or the heart. The heart has a constant volume, and the boundaries of the heart change. This one, so that it contracts or expands. Okay. Due to compression and expansion, you have that energy added to the flow, and this is positive displacement pump. Or you can have the water well pump. You can see that this one moves up and down, and here you have the piston, okay? And that piston boundaries change, and you are adding and taking energy of the fluid. Okay. Or this is the tire pump. You can see again here you have that piston, and that piston changes the volume in this amount, V delta V, volume displaced. Okay. You have this amount of displaced volume, and within that this amount of the displaced volume, you are doing the work, and also that you are squeezing fluid out or sucking fluid in. Or that home flow meter, okay, flow meter that is used for our homes for measuring the water flow at our homes. This is also that positive displacement flow meter. Okay. And here that again you have that constant amount of the volume. Here you have constant amount of volume. And here you have nutating disc. If you are interested, you can look at it. And this nutating disc, this one wobbles around, and as it wobbles around, it displaces a constant amount of the volume inside this flow meter. And this one is also a positive displacement machine. Okay. This one is complex, therefore you have to look at the videos of it to understand how it works. Okay, so that for the turbo machines, if you remember, we have two types, the positive displacement ones or the turbo machines. But for the turbo machines, we don't have any closed volume. Okay, this is open. You can see that the water comes, if you look at in there, that is the fluid comes and it is in contact with the blades here, rotor. Okay, so that each of these turbo machines, they have the rotor. Okay, and sometimes it is possible that they have rotor as well as that stator. Okay, and these are, as the name says, they are stationary, and these ones are moved. And the rotor can take different names. It can be that you can call it as the impeller. Okay. Or you can, the famous one is the impeller that is used for the pumps. Okay. It can be that wheel type. Okay. So any type of the, so that these rotors, they have the blades. Okay. And as the blades rotate, these are the blades here. You can see the blades as they are rotating, and they are adding energy to the fluid or getting energy out of the fluid. And the turbo means that spin in Latin, and also called the rotating equipment. And here you don't have any closed volume. This is the very important one. And here you have the axial fan. You can see that flow comes and goes in that direction. And you have this Pelton turbine. You can see how large it is. Okay. And these are here the buckets. Yeah, bucket is also that you can see, impeller, wheel, or you can have that bucket. These buckets are rotating on the wheel. This is the wheel. They are rotating, and as they are rotating, they are taking energy of the fluid. Okay, and this is the shaft. So this is the energy of the Azerbaijan, and you can see that this is how we get electricity in Azerbaijan. Okay, so we have that. These are the energy distribution of Azerbaijan, and we have two types of the energy that we are getting. One is that thermal, okay, and the other groups are the hydropower. You can see that thermal ones are using that either steam, okay, and or they are using the gas or air. Okay. These are the thermal ones. For hydropower ones, we are using that hydraulic turbines. Okay. And the hydraulic turbines, in other words, you can say we are using water. And you can see that the largest power plant is Azerbaijan. This is name of it. Okay, this is name of the power plant. This gives off 24 megawatts, and you have the other power plants here. You can see the first, the Azerbaijan power plant is 24 megawatts, but total power plants, that all of them in Azerbaijan, it gives the 6,700 megawatts. Okay, and the percentage of Azerbaijan power plant, this one is 24 megawatts. And over the total one, 6, 7, 1, 30. It is around that 86%. Okay. You can see that most of the power is we got from this Azerbaijan power plant. It is the name. Okay, so that we can also have the Mingechevir. You can see the high amount of it, 424 megawatts. And for this ones, steam or gas, for the thermal power plants, we are either using the fuel oil or we are using natural gas. So we are either using the fuel oil and we are oil using this natural gas. Okay. And then this is a picture of the turbine and how the turbine works. So you have the water here and that water comes in that way. You can see that this is the dam here. This one is dam. Okay. That water comes into that dam and then rotates the turbine here and you get electricity. And as it leaves, it goes through the draft tube and the tail race and leaves the system here. And for the Mingechevir hydropower, you can see it. Here you are the, you can see that these are the penstock. These are called penstock. You can see this part is the dam and the water goes in that direction. You can see. And then it goes in that way. And here you have the turbines. You have one turbine here, another water passage, you have second turbine here, another water passage, you have third turbine, one more here, fourth turbine, and one more here, five, and one more here, you have the six. Okay. For example, in Mingechevir, you have six turbines. Okay. And this is the where you have got the turbine. So you have one turbine here, you can see, you have second one here, and the third one, and the fourth one, and the five, and you have one more here, which is six. You have six turbines, and these are the outlets. You can see these are the tail rays. And this one, water leaves, and water leaves, water leaves, water leaves. And these are the turbines inside the Mingechevir. You can see the numbers, and the one, and you have two here, you have three here, four, and five, and six. You have six turbines. And all of these turbines are on the Francis-type turbines, okay? And but here you have one more additional in that is machine. You can see these ones. So you have one and the two and the three, four, five and the six. So my question will come to you that what are these? What do you think that these devices are? What do you think are they? You have any idea you can tell me in hydropower where we use the power of the water? Why do we need this? That is these buildings here. Why do we need this construction here? This one is Mingechevir. Do you have any idea what are these construction sites here? Why do we need it? We don't have any idea. Okay, so that these are called that surge tanks. So why do we need the surge tanks? Let's talk about this one. So this is the reason that we need the surge tanks, water hammer. Okay. So there is an animation here. So you can see that when you close the valve, so let me start from the beginning. When you close the valve suddenly, so you can see it suddenly closes, the pressure wave moves up and comes back. So you can see that pressure wave moves up and down. You can see that this one fluctuates. You can see the pressure change in a wave manner. You can see it suddenly closes. And you have this pressure fluctuations. You can see the pressure fluctuation inside the pipe. And this is the pressure moves up and down and moves up and down. One more time. Okay. So this is called the water hammer. So if you sudden closure of the valve, if you close it, you have the local compression, the density change. Okay. That density change So the local compression, that sudden change of density, creates pressure waves. Okay. That pressure waves, you can see the wave type here. It moves up and down. You can see that pressure wave. And then it stops, okay. And then it gets some constant value. But this pressure wave can vibrate or damage the pipe. The pipe, even it can, you know, that the burst the pipe. Okay, so then this is the problem with this sudden closure of the valve. Okay. And then for the Mingəçevir, and you can see the surge tanks, that is the reason that we need surge tanks to prevent the water hammer. Because that when this process happens, it is like that you are hammering the pipe, okay, the sound of hammering the pipe. We have the similar sounds, and therefore it is called water hammer. How do we prevent it? We are preventing it by using the bellows. Okay, I don't know that if you have seen bellows, it is a structure something like this one. You have a structure. Okay. And these are in trains. If you have seen the bellows in trains, so when the train's velocity changes, okay, when the train velocity changes, or if there is compression or tension, if you have a force on it, these bellows are, you know, that contracted. So they contract and come together and then expand, contract and expand. Similarly here, if you want to arrest the water hammer, you have to use this bellows here. This is the one way. And another way is that you have the surge tower. And the surge tower is that you can see that if the pressure changes here, the pressure changes at this location here, the water, if it goes back, it is collected in this surge tank. Okay. If you have a sudden increase, the water collects there. If you have sudden drop, water goes in that way. Okay. It is like that it regulates the pressure variations inside these pipes. If you have pressure increase, the water can move in that way. It is released its pressure. If there is a pressure drop, that pressure drop is, you know, that accompanied by this water from this surge tank. Or you have that hydraulic accumulator tank. Okay, what is that? So this one is, say that this is the pipe flow and the water flows inside that pipe. And at some location of that pipe, you put it is like a balloon. You put this one. Okay. And on one part of the balloon, say that here. Here you have that air. And the water flows in that direction. When you here you have that pressure change, delta P. And what happens? The water compresses this one. Because you have that delta P and the volume drops. And the air is compressed in that part. Therefore, you don't have any damage to the pipeline here, and only the volume change in some place. That therefore, to prevent any pressure wave or to any relief, to relieve any pressure increase or decrease, we are doing the opposite. Instead of that compression, you are using expansion. Okay. So that this bellows or that surge tower or this accumulator tanks. Okay. And this is the inside the Mingəçevir power plant, and you can see that control house. This one is the control house. And even if you look carefully, you can see some values here. For example, this is the rotation power of the, so this is RPM. You can see that RPM here is 150 RPMs. Okay. So this one is RPM, 150. You can see that this RPM, 150 RPMs, it makes 50 radians per second. It is frequency, but this is the frequency of electricity. Okay. Electricity is having frequency of 50 by 1 second. As this one is that the turbine is moving at 50 radians per second, but electricity needs 50 radians per second. Therefore, you can use some gear mechanisms here to couple the velocities. And also you have these values here. You can see that power here and etc. If you are interested, you can look at the chart here and get the values. And this is the control house. Okay, now we are continuing with the pumps here. And the pumps, they have that used for the increasing the pressure. That is the main purpose of the pump. But they are only used to increase the pressure. That's all. So that if you have that, the velocity, even in pumps, you can have the same velocity. you can have that same velocity at inlet and the outlet. Because that think that this one is your pump. You have that inlet diameter of D and the outlet diameter of, again, the same one. Okay. Since we know that the mass flow rate is rho AV is constant. And for water, the rho is also constant. And therefore, AV will be constant. Since area is constant, you will have that V is constant for the pump here. Therefore, the pump doesn't increase the velocity if the diameters are the same. So what happens then if the velocity is not increased, the pump increases the pressure. You have higher pressure. And this pressure is energy. If you need kinetic energy, for example, velocity at later steps, you can convert that pressure into velocity so that the velocity increase or decrease by area change. You will have that area change, and therefore you can convert the pressure energy to velocity. That P to velocity. You can change it by area change. So therefore, if the area doesn't change, the kinetic energy is constant, doesn't increase or decrease, but the pressure may change due to loss. Okay, and the famous pump is that centrifugal pump, and it is also called the radial pump. And for the radial pump, you have that inlet in that direction, and you have that outlet in that direction. So inlet and the outlets are in radial ways. You can see that one moves in that direction and lives in the opposite direction. And this one is the centrifugal pump. And there are some terms for the centrifugal pump. You have the I here, that is the place where the water enters. You have that inflow. You can see that inflow goes from the I. You have that blades. You can see the blades here. You have these blades. These are the blades. This one is blade. And you have that blade here too. You have that blade too. You have that blade too. And also you have the casing here. You can see casing around it. You can see that casing. And similarly, you have this casing here. And but if you notice that the inside this casing, the area increases. So here you have that area one in that amount. As you move, you can see that area two. And then you have that, this one is the area three. So that area three is greater than area two, and that's greater than area one. So what is the reason? The reason is that, so if you go in the similar approach that velocity three is less than velocity two is less than velocity one, you can see that pump even decreases the velocity. See that? So what happens then? Why do we do that? The reason is that you convert, so you are converting kinetic energy to pressure energy. So what you are doing, you are converting the kinetic energy into the pressure energy. As you increase the area, it becomes that pressure energy. Later, you can use that pressure energy. As I said, you play with the area, you can convert that pressure energy to velocity by area change. If you decrease area, you will have that kinetic energy. Okay, this is the essence of the centrifugal pump. And it works with the, you can see the term here, the centrifugal force. And this design of the centrifugal pumps is a more than 200 years, the people are doing designs on it. And even today, they are trying to make it more efficient with working on these blades. And the next term is that pump head. And this is the total energy of pump. Total energy of pump. This is total energy, actually, of pump given to fluid. So given to fluid. This is the total energy of the pump that is given into the fluid and the per unit weight of fluid. Okay. So that is called the head. Head is the energy per weight. For example, if the pump gives you potential energy, that potential energy will be mgz. The weight of fluid is mg, and that one will be z. Delta Z, actually. So for the pump, the total head is given by the Bernoulli's equation, and it is the difference of the sum of pressure head, the velocity head, and the potential head, minus again the, so this one is outlet, and this one will be the inlet. The difference between the pressure, velocity, and the potential head at outlet minus the inlet. Okay. And we have also that water horsepower, and it is the useful power given to the fluid, and this one will be that m dot gh. Okay, similar to potential energy. And this is the general configuration for the pump. You have that velocity inlet, diameter and the density inlet. You can see that this is the height that before the pump and this is the height after the pump. And you have that velocity before the pump and the velocity after the pump. And this is the pump. And also you have the diameters are given. And you can notice that pressure value here. At the beginning, it is 1 atm. And at the outlet, it is that 3 atm. Okay. But you should notice that these are absolute pressures. This one is absolute and this one is absolute. Okay. And this is the total head of the pump. The difference between the outlet values, which is kinetic energy, which is pressure energy, you can see it. And this one is that potential energy, the difference between these two. And you have that the efficiency term for the pump. That efficiency is there. So you can see that to rotate the pump here, you need some motor. Okay, that motor, you can see the shaft here. It is connected with some shaft and the coupling here. So that you are giving some BHP. Okay, you can see that BHP here. This BHP is required to rotate the impeller or rotor of the pump. Okay. That BHP is not the same as the water, so the power supplied to the water. This BHP1 and this one are different. Okay. This is the term that we use for the efficiency of the pump. Efficiency of the pump is that energy or power supplied to water divided by energy supplied to rotate the impeller. And see, this BHP is the brake horsepower. This one is brake horsepower at the supplied to rotate the impeller. This is one is the downstairs, and for the upstairs, you will have that energy supplied to the water. This one is the efficiency of the pump. And this efficiency, you have this efficiency problems. The reason is that you have the losses. Why do we have losses? First loss, the reason is that you have the flow separation. So because that, if you think of the, let me go back to here, you see that these are the impellers of the pump. These are the blades of the pump. There is flow separation on blade surface. So if this is the blade surface, on that blade surface, what is our purpose? Our purpose is that these blades are in contact with water here. You can see that water. It is in contact with water and it gives its energy to water. So blade, so rotation energy. So it is imparted to water. So if there is separation, what will be that the case? In that separation case, this is the blade. Here we'll have that blade, and this one is separation. And you will have water here on that surface, but here you will not have a water. But this part will be empty. Okay, this part is empty. So that blade rotates, but in some part of it, you have water, here you have water, and here you don't have any water. So it means that the rotational energy of the blade is wasted, okay? That rotational energy of the blade is wasted. It is not given to the water, but it rotates empty. And this is the one reason that you have the losses. Second reason is that you can have that misalignment. So you will see that in for perfect pump, so this one is the second one, for the perfect efficiency or high efficiency, what you want is that water should come in that direction, in tangent direction, and it should live in the tangent direction. It may be possible that this one is misaligned, it comes in that way, or it comes in that way. Okay. If there is misalignment with the full inlet flow velocity, with the geometry of the blades, you will have that flow losses. Okay. And you have that frictional losses, fluidic friction losses. This one is that viscosity. Okay. Because that flow moves over blade, and the blades are solid materials, and the over that solid material, you will have that friction, and that friction will create losses. And also mechanical friction losses, because you have the bearings, rotating equipment, etc. And there you have the frictional losses, and etc. These are the main reasons that we have that flow losses, or the pump efficiency problem. And there is also a pump performance curve, okay. The pump performance curve, the name says it, it shows the performance of the pump in terms of its head, how its head changes with respect to volume flow rate of water, how its efficiency changes, how the brake horsepower changes. Okay, brake horsepower, I will reiterate it one more time. It is the energy or power that is supplied by this motor here, You have the energy supplied by this motor. Rotate the impeller here. Okay, this is the brake horsepower. Okay, so the graph of that net head of the pump, efficiency of the pump, brake horsepower supplied to the pump with respect to volume flow rate, it is called the pump performance curve. But this one is given us for one rotational speed of the impeller. This one is for one rotational speed. So because that the impeller, this one rotates. So it can rotate at any omega, but the curve is for one omega, let's say that 1000 RPM. At different RPM, you can have different curves. Okay? And as you can notice that the net head supplied by the pump, it drops. And also efficiency gets some high value at some point here. You can see the maximum efficiency, then it drops again, and then it drops again. And the brake horsepower, at the beginning it is less, and then it increases, and then drops again. And this V dot is the flow rate of water, flow rate of fluid. Okay. This is called the performance curve of the pump. So why do we need it? So you will see that we need it. We have to select the pump for our requirement. Say that you have a building, or you have a pipeline system, any case, you need a pump. How do we select the pump? By looking at its performance curve. You look at the performance curve of the pump and you say that this is the pump that I want, or this is not the required pump. And there are two important points on the pump performance curve. One is that shutoff head, and the other one is that free delivery. Okay. What is the shutoff head? So that shutoff head is that if I go back to here, but this one is the liquid out and this one is the liquid in. So if I close the outlet, so let me do that. So you close it, close. And if you close it, there will not be any flow rate. V dot will be zero. Okay. Then the pump will have the maximum pressure because outlet is closed. So in that case, you will have that P max or the H max. Net head max by pump. Because you have closed the outlet, the pump provides the maximum pressure. But for the centrifugal pumps, it's a problem. Okay, the centrifugal pumps, if you close the outlet, it can damage the pump. But it is a chart that they can prepare for some time, okay, for a short brief of time, you close it and they get the values. This is the shutoff head. You have the zero volume flow rate, but the maximum head. You can see that this one is the maximum. Here you don't have any useful work. There is no useful work because the flow rate is zero. So you can see it here. The efficiency of the pump is measured by that water horsepower divided by BHP. The water horsepower is that rho V dot GH. If there is no V dot, there is no efficiency. And there is no efficiency means that at this point you don't have any efficiency. Water horsepower is zero because this one was rho V dot and the G into H. And on the other side, you have that maximum flow rate. What is that maximum flow rate? The maximum flow rate is that. So if this is the pump, okay, and this is the outlet. If you have a valve here, that is the valve. Okay, so the closed valve means that you have that P max. Okay, and then you open and open the valve. Fully open valve means that, fully open valve, it means that no pressure, because the valve is fully open and the pump only supplies the volume flow rate. Okay, but you have that maximum flow rate. In other words, the pressure of the pump that is supplied by the pump, this P max, it is all converted to kinetic energy. Here you have that all P by pump to kinetic energy. The pressure that the pump can supply, all of it is converted to kinetic energy. That is called that free delivery point. And here also, you don't have any load on the pump. You don't have any load and H is zero. And the pump is doing no useful work. Here again, you have that efficiency is zero. Why the efficiency here is zero for the second case? Because here you don't have any resistance. No resistance means that if I have a pressure against the pump will do a work against this pressure. It is like the friction. You have force, you have to do some work to overcome that force. But for the free delivery part, you don't have that force because that there is no pressure. If there is no pressure, then it means that there is no resistance against the pump. There is no any resistance against the pump. The pump is not doing any useful work and therefore efficiency is zero. You have zero efficiency here, you have zero efficiency here, but in between you have this curve, something like this one. This is the shot of head and this is the free delivery. And then now comes the best efficiency point on the pump curve. The best efficiency point is that you have the maximum efficiency. So maximum eta. What we want is that we want a pump, we want a pump that operates at its maximum efficiency point. Okay, so let me give you one example. Say that if for a building, I will just give you an example for a building, and you need a volume flow rate of 20 liters per second for that building. And for that building, you have also calculated that losses, which is HL major plus HL minor. You have also calculated that it becomes 40 meters. Okay, for this flow rate, and this is the loss of the building. And what we will do is that we will need a pump. Okay, what should the pump? We will need the pump that operates at 20 liters per second. And at that V dot of 20 liters per second, it should give the head of 40 meters. Because this is the loss of my system. This is the pump that I want. I want a pump that can, you know, that give energy to a height of 40 meters with a volume flow rate of 20 liters per second. That is what you want. Okay. But we also want that to be at the maximum efficiency. Because if it happens at maximum efficiency, you will have that minimum. So you will have minimum BHP, and minimum BHP means that cost, less cost. You will have that less cost because BHP means electricity. This one is electricity that you require. So therefore, this best efficiency point is the one that we want. Okay. So here the values are shown with star. Similarly, BHP star. Now comes the system curve. Okay, till now, we were talking about the pump curve. Okay, you can see that pump curve and the pump curve, all of these are about the pump, how pump operates. And this pump curve are also called that supply curve. This is the supply curve. These are all about the pump. Now what we will talk about is that system curve or demand curve. Okay. It is like that. Let me give you one example from economy. You know it. So that this one is this demand curve. From economy, you know that somebody, this one is that sale. Okay. Say that sale of chocolate. Okay. And what is the that operating point for the sale of chocolate, and there should be for this sale of chocolate a demand for that chocolate. Okay. And you should have that this is the sale of chocolate, at the same time you should have the demand for it. Okay. And demand is at say that this one. Okay, this is the point where you have that demand. Okay. Similarly here, I have a pump. That pump provides me this amount of energy. I pump. And we are showing that energy with H. I have also demand curve. Okay? And my demand curve could be something like this one. And it could be something like this one, or it could be something like this one. And these are the intersections of the demand curves with the supply curves. Now the system curve, this is the losses of system. And it is also called that demand curve we have talked about. I have a suction reservoir here. I have a discharge reservoir. And in between, I have that pump that operates. Okay. For this system, I should calculate the losses. What are the amount of the losses? I will write energy balance between point A and the point B, and this is the energy balance that I'm going to have, and it will be that PA is atmospheric pressure, PB is atmospheric pressure, velocities are the same, you have the same velocities, and the usable head of the pump will be that height of the B, this one is the ZB, and the height of A, which is ZA, and plus the head loss through the system. Okay, this head loss may be major and it can be minor, both of them. Okay. And this is the usable head that the pump should supply. Okay. And what you can do is that you can play with this system curve here, and then before doing that, so this pump usable head, this is the one that we want from the pump. Okay. And the delta Z is the height difference and the HL is the losses. And instead of that, once you can write the formula here, HL is this one, and delta, that this part is the minor loss, and this part is the major loss. Okay. And then you replace the velocities with volume flow rate. Okay. And instead of velocity, you have the volume flow rate. And we collect the terms as K, which are constants. You can see that this one is constant, G is constant, A is constant. Okay. These are constants. Okay, and the final term becomes that HL is proportional to constant into V dot squared. And therefore, the pump usable head becomes delta Z plus K into V dot squared. This is the pump usable head. Okay, you can see I've come from this one. I've calculated this part and this equation here. Then I moved to this part, at HL part. I have replaced the HL with volume flow rate. And then I replace that useful head of the pump with this quantity here. Okay. Now you can see that pump useful head is proportional to volume flow rate squared in a parabolic manner, this curve, and you can have that curve if you increase the K value here. Okay. If you increase the K value, you will have these curves here, and you have that curve, and you have this curve here. And if you increase the delta Z value, the curve moves up and up and up. This is the system curve and how it depends on the delta Z and that flow rate multiplied with K. Okay. And now comes the duty point, and this is the important point that we are interested in. Duty point is the point where you have that system curve. This one is the system curve and this one is the supply line. They are intersecting at one point, and that point is called duty point. Okay, this is the point where pump operates. At this point, the pump works on, and it operates always at this location here. So I have given one example for you, and the example statement is as, say that we have a building, okay, and we have calculated that HL is 78 meters. Okay. For that building, we want volume flow rate of 320 liters per second. This is the process that we have. We have a building with head loss of 78 meters and with volume flow rate of 320 liters per second. Now, what we will want is that we want pump. Okay, we want a pump. What you will do is that there are different performance pump curves. Okay, pump performance curves. So I have looked for the taco pumps. And if you go to that website, this is the website, and you can click on it and you can see the chart here. So these are the catalogs of the different pumps. You can see the numbers of the pumps. And see, these are all different pumps. Okay. But the point that I want is that at 320 liters per second, so I should work with that liters per second part, which is this one. You can see. This is 320 liters per second, very close to 315. And also I need the 78 meters. But this part is head in feet and this part is head in meter. I need 78 meters. See it here. This one is 78 and this one is 320. I need a pump that can provide me 78 meters of energy loss. Okay, this one is the loss should be provided by pump. And also I need a pump that can supply me this amount of flow rate. This is again by pump. Okay. These both should be supplied by the pump. So from a different range of the pumps, I have found that this one is the one that I want. Okay. Now what I will do is that I will go the chart for that specific pump, for that pump. Okay, now let's see the chart for that pump. You can see the model here. So this one is the 121018, the same one here. This is the model of the pump. Now the chart for that model of the pump is something like this one. You can see lots of numbers here, lots of graphs here. So what does it mean? So let's talk about the parts of that chart. Here you have that head in feet, again, similarly, you have that head in meters. Okay. You have also head in kilopascals. And you have this feet, which is NPSH, net required, net positive suction head. We'll talk about this one in next slides. And the flow in gallons per minute and the flow in liters. You can see that these are the liters per second. And what we want is that 320 is something like this one. And we have that 78 meters, something like this one. And this is the pump, will give you 78 meters and 320 liters per second. Okay. And then for this location here, so you can see that you need this, this size of impeller, which is 412 millimeters. Okay. At this location, now let's see the efficiency of our pump. Here you have that efficiency curves, which is 85%. You have next efficiency curve, which is 84%. Okay. And have next efficiency 83% curve. These are constant. Okay. On this curve, you have 83%. Here you have 84%. Any value between this one will have that range of values from 83% to 84%. And our pump is between 85%, you can see 85% curve, this one is constant on that line. Okay. You have 86% too here. And our pump is at 86%. It can be a little less than that one, but it's very close to that one. Therefore, we select that eta will be 86%. Okay. Now comes the BHP curve of the pump. Okay, BHP curve of the pump will be, you can see that these are the BHP lines, the dashed lines. This is the BHP for 200 HP or that 149 kilowatts. You have also 250 HP. You have that 350 HP. You have that 350. And what I need is that the value that is close to that one. Okay. And to find that is close to that one. So let me see that. And it is between 400 HP value here. And see 400 HP and 450 HP. And therefore my pump is very close to 400 HP and it can be that 400, let's say 20 HP. You have to look at it. So it is between 400 and 450. And it's actually 420, 10 actually, it is less than that one. But if you go to the website, but you will see that this one gives the website gives you the accurate value for the HP. Okay. And also one more thing here is that you can see that I've set different impeller sizes. Because when you buy the pump, there are different impellers inside that casing. Okay. Therefore, you have to be sure that which impeller should be installed. And you get that impeller size from this point here. Okay. And you also have here that minimum impeller diameter, which is that 13.7 inches, okay? And you have that outlet diameter of the pump and inlet diameter of the pump. You can see that outlet diameter is larger than inlet diameter, okay? Since outlet diameter is larger, the velocity at outlet is greater than velocity at inlet, sorry, less than. So from this pump, the velocity drops, okay? But pressure increases, of course. And this is the maximum impeller size. These are all in inches. Okay. This one is the rotational speed of the pump that will operate 1760 RPMs. It will use that rotational speed. And now comes that similarity laws for the pump. Okay. We are using the similarity laws. So say that you have this impeller size, okay, and now you want to work with a different impeller size, okay, what will be the performance when you work with a different impeller size or when you work at a different rotational speed, okay? For these options, we have a similarity laws for the pumps. And these similarity laws are used to estimate the power pump performance, a different impeller size or with a different rotational speed. For this one, we are using the Buckingham's Pi theorem, okay? And as using Buckingham's Pi theorem for the GH, and this one is the dependent variable as a function of volume, flow rate, and diameter, density, and the blade surface roughness, and omega, and the viscosity. This one we have talked about in our previous lecture. And we are selecting that GH as a function of that V dot, and then diameter, and then density, and then epsilon, and omega, and mu. We select that GH as a function of these ones, and also you select that BHP as a function of the same variables. Okay. And by using Buckingham's Pi theorem, you find these variables here. This one is the Pi 1, this one is the Pi 2, and this one is the Pi 3, and this one is the Pi 4. Okay. Similarly for the BHP, you will find one variable that is different from that one. The rest will be the same, okay? And this one will be that Pi 5. The rest Pi's of the BHP will be the same as this one's here, okay? And from these three non-dimensional parameters, there are the names for three of them, which is that head coefficient, there's a name for it, there is capacity coefficient, and there's power coefficient, okay? This one has a name, and this one has a name, and that one, Pi 5, it has a name. This one is called power coefficient, capacity coefficient, and head coefficient. For similarity of pumps, okay, if you are looking for the similarity of pumps, so this term here and that term here, not important. Okay. And for similarity of pumps, only these three ones, CH, CQ, and the CP are important. Okay, and these are also called that affinity laws. So if you have the similar pumps, that CP1 should be same as CP2, CQ1 should be same as CQ2, and the CH1 should be same as CH2. These are all four similar pumps. Okay, as I said, you don't pay attention to this, which is Reynolds number, and this one is the relative roughness. These are not playing a major role for the similarity of the pumps. Okay. So now comes the case one. Say that I have a pump A, okay, and I am using this pump A. The impeller size are the same, but I'm using at a different rotational speed. Say that this one is at 1000 RPMs, and I want to operate the pump as 1500 RPMs. And trying to find how the values will change. The same pump A and the pump B, these are similar pumps. For these similar pumps, I'm trying to understand what happens when I change the rotational speed of the pump. But you should remember that the diameter is the same. You have the diameter here, you have the diameter here. They are the same diameters, but at a different rotational speed. You will see that on that case, the volume flow rate will be proportional to the omega for the first power, and the head of the pump will be omega proportional to the second power, and the BHP will change to the third power with respect to omega. Okay. So here you have say that 8 watts or the 2 watts, and if the rotational speed is 1000, and if you increase the rotational speed of the 1500 RPMs, and the BHP 2 will be equal to BHP 1, which is 2, and multiplied with that 1500 RPM and divide by 1000 RPMs to the power of 3. You can see power change in the third power when you increase the rotational speed of the pump. These are all from Buckingham's Pi theorem. Now comes the second option. So I keep the rotational speed the same. This one is 100 RPMs and this one is 100 RPM. But I use my different impeller size. If you remember, I've said that there are lots of impellers with the same pump. Okay. You are changing the impeller size, different impeller. On that case, volume flow rate will change in the third power with diameter, head will change in the second power to the diameter, and the power will change the fifth power. You can see how it changes a lot. Therefore, if you change the diameter, you have this change in the power. Okay. And these are the similarity laws. And there is another important stuff for the pumps, which is the pump cavitation. What is pump cavitation? The pump cavitation is that when you have the impeller operating inside the pump, so you have the flow rate into that pump, and you have that flow rate out of that pump, okay? Say that this pump operates at 20 degrees Celsius, okay? For 100 degrees Celsius, and we know that the saturation pressure is 101 kilopascal. Okay. For this pressure, the water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. If I have that saturation pressure of around 3 kilopascal, okay, the water boils at 25 degrees Celsius or 20 degrees Celsius. Or if you have this amount of low pressure, the water starts to boil. And inside the pump, as these ones rotate, you have high kinetic energy. That high kinetic energy sites will have very low pressure. Okay, so very low pressure. It is possible that this pressure inside the pump is less than 3 kilopascals. Okay. If it is less than 3 kilopascals, here you will have that boiling locations. Okay. Here you have the boiling locations, and the boiling locations means that you have these vapors. Okay. This one are the vapors. This is the first part of the process. Now next comes, and the pump rotates and pushes this one to out of the system. Okay. And also inside the region here, you have high pressure zones. These are at low pressure zones. And in high pressure zones, so what happens as the bubbles move, say that, and they come together here everywhere, and you have that high P and high pressure everywhere and high pressure everywhere and high pressure everywhere. Okay. And these are the vapor bubbles. And these high pressure zones compress on these bubbles, and they come together, and then what will happen is that they will explode. These bubbles may come together, okay, and then they will explode, because there is inside the pump you have the low pressure zones where you have the creation of the bubble, and you have the high pressure zones where you have the explosion of that bubble, and during that explosion you will have that noise, you have that vibration, and this one will reduce efficiency and damage the impeller plate. Okay. This is called the cavitation, and it can also create erosion on the pump surface. Okay. And so we have to be sure that the pump doesn't operate less than P saturation. We have to be sure that the pump doesn't operate less than P saturation, otherwise you will have that cavitation problem. Now let's see how they can be sure that the cavitation is not there. We have to find this net positive suction head. Okay. This net positive suction head, that this one NPSH, is P inlet plus rho g of the pump, velocity inlet squared of the pump by 2g minus saturation pressure by rho g. This is called net positive suction head. This NPSH should be less than, because it should be greater than or equal to NPSH required. This required value is given by manufacturer. Okay. Manufacturer gives you this value. And this one that you are having here, you calculate it. Okay. If the calculated NPSH is greater than that one, there will not be cavitation. The cavitation will not occur. If it is less than that one, you will have that cavitation problem inside the pump. So how do we calculate this one? This one you calculate, as I said, and this one is by manufacturer. So how do we calculate the available NPSH? So to calculate it, you are writing energy balance between the reservoir and the inlet of the pump. If you write the energy equation between inlet and the point A, so this one is reservoir, this one is the inlet of the pump, and you will have this equation here. And the pressure at A is 1 atm, and the velocity at A is 0 because it is reservoir. At the end, you will have this equation here. Okay. P inlet by rho g plus V inlet squared by 2g, it will be equal to that value here. And I know that NPSH available is formula. Okay. It should be P inlet by rho g plus that V inlet squared by 2g minus P saturation by rho g. And I have found that this term is equal to that one. Okay. If I subtract the P sat by rho g from that term and as well as from this term, I will get NPSH. NPSH will be equal to that one. Okay. This is called the NPSH available. And you calculate. And if it is greater than the required NPSH, you will not have the cavitation. But if it is less than the NPSH required, you will have that cavitation problem. Now let's see the chart here. So if you look at the chart, you can see the NPSH required here. You can see NPSH required. Okay. This is the NPSH required chart. And the values are shown here. So you have the kilopascal and the feet. You can see NPSH here. We are looking for the kilopascal units. Okay. For example, I'm trying to find the NPSH at 500 liters per second. For that one, required value is 120 kilopascal. So at 500 liters per second, we have 120 kilopascal of NPSH available. Sorry, required. Okay. This one is given us that kilopascal unit, it is by just rho gh. So that overall, so if I summarize the cavitation, so you will not have the cavitation in two cases. One is that you can see that the H value, the net head of the pump should be greater than required NPSH and the required NPSH and also available NPSH should be greater than required NPSH value here. If you don't want a cavitation, this one should be greater than NPSH required, and also NPSH available should be greater than NPSH required, and you should calculate them and to be sure that there is no cavitation. Okay.